The oft-quoted myth that our constitution is a borrowed one, and that our constituent assembly did nothing more than to stitch together parts from different constitutions. The reason why I say that is because it suggests an answer to whether the constitution today has relevance or otherwise. The allegations of our constitution being heavily borrowed are as old as the constitution itself. Some of the members of the Constituent Assembly were in fact very vocal in expressing their concerns. One member called it the music of a Western band, as opposed to the veena or the sitar. Another member of the Constituent Assembly called it a slavish surrender to the West. These allegations received a reply from Babasaheb Ambedkar, who said, and Dr. Singhvi quoted a part of that little response, "There is nothing to be ashamed of in borrowing," he said. "It involves no plagiarism. Nobody holds any patent rights in the fundamental ideas of a constitution." Before I embark on this task to dispel the myth that our constitution is a borrowed constitution, let me briefly address the question as to why the uniqueness or the Indianness of our constitution is even relevant to begin with. Why should we be asking ourselves this question? To understand this, we must ask ourselves, what role does a constitution play in our society? Michel Rosenfield, a leading scholar in comparative constitutional law, posits that constitutions often take people as they are and yet seek to make something more out of them by ascribing on them an identity through their text. Often, the identity is created by referring to narratives of sameness and selfhood, along with offering a common aspiration for the future. Hence, it would not be amiss to say that a constitution such as ours, which was created as an outcome of political struggle and a revolutionary freedom movement, was important in bringing about unity and stability to a young nation. However, while our constitution serves as the base upon which we find our identity as we the people, it is equally imperative that we are able to identify our constitution as Indian too. With this in mind, I begin with my task of taking you through the history of some of our provisions. Any discussion of this nature must first begin by addressing the claim that the concept of fundamental rights in Part 3 has been borrowed from the American Bill of Rights. However, one would not have to travel too far to realize that the idea of a set of inviolable justiciable rights, which are fundamental to every citizen, had been vehemently argued for throughout our freedom struggle, and the ultimate list of protected rights had grown organically. This organic exercise in the creation of our fundamental rights began with the Constitution of India Bill of 1895, believed to have been inspired by Lokmanya Tilak. It set forth a variety of rights, including those of free speech, imprisonment only by a competent authority, and of free state education. This was followed by the Commonwealth of India Bill of 1925, which was authored by Annie Besant. Within it were seven provisions for fundamental rights, stating that individual liberty, freedom of conscience, free expression of opinion, free assembly, and equality before the law were to be guaranteed. In other words, far from the Constitution borrowing notions of liberty from the West or from the American Constitution, our Constitution really was born in the context of a history of suppression and of the struggle for freedom. Ultimately, the fundamental rights contained in our Constitution were in a large part derived from the Fundamental Rights Chapter of the Nehru Report of 1928, which was a product of the 43rd annual session of the Indian National Congress. Taken together, these documents highlight how the concept of guaranteed fundamental rights for all citizens of India was almost 50 years in the making when the Constituent Assembly considered it for the first time. Moreover, if one needed more proof that the rights framework in Part 3 has evolved from the debates within our freedom movement and can be seen as distinct from the American Bill of Rights, one would only have to look at the Due Process Clause in both the constitutions. When the grounds for restricting the ambit of Article 21 were under consideration in the Constituent Assembly, the Assembly was at a crossroads between the phrase due process, which is found in the American Constitution, and procedure established by law, as found in the Japanese Constitution. To find an answer, Dr. B.N. Rao, the constitutional advisor, visited Justice Felix Frankfurter, as is well known, a sitting U.S. Supreme Court judge. Justice Frankfurter advised B.N. Rao that the due process provision had resulted in striking down of several beneficial legislations in the United States and was a hindrance in the welfare schemes of the government. This was the immediate product of the years of the Great Depression, when court after court was striking down in the United States laws relating to minimum wages or fair conditions of work. Therefore, in view of the nascent state of the Indian economy, our founding fathers and our framers deemed it fit to incorporate procedure established by law to protect beneficial legislation from challenges in the courts. The social and economic needs of the country played an important role in deciding the course. India was born in that sense in the backdrop of disruption. India was born in the backdrop of a sense where there was doubt whether India would survive as a nation. India was born from the perspective of the disruptions of partition. Therefore, the Constitution, as it was originally envisaged, contemplated a strong center where there was a need to preserve, as it were, the stability of one nation. And we will come to how that notion has been altered as the years have now gone by. Post the adoption of the Constitution, of course, our Supreme Court ultimately did move away from this understanding, which I will now address very shortly. A second and related set of provisions which have been alleged to be borrowed are the directive principles of state policy in Part 4. It has been argued that they were borrowed from the Irish Constitution. However, significantly, it was the Karachi Resolution, which was adopted by a session of the Congress in March 1931, which first extended the sphere of rights from purely negative rights to an articulation of the positive obligations to provide the citizens with the economic and social conditions in which their negative rights would have actual meaning. The Karachi Resolution can be seen as a spiritual and direct antecedent of the directive principles. Moreover, it was a Sapru report of 1945 which helped outline the fundamental distinction between what is justiciable and non-justiciable in terms of rights, which came to be embodied in Part 3 and Part 4 of the Constitution. Hence, we find that discussions about the nature of positive, non-justiciable rights took place in the Indian freedom movement long before the Constituent Assembly came into existence. Moving on, if we were to look at concepts such as secularism and federalism, their interpretation in India is unique. I think it would be a misnomer to suggest that secularism as a concept was born into the Constitution as a result of the 42nd Amendment. To my mind, the 42nd Amendment recognized something which was basically an underpinning of the Constitution. You cannot understand the Constitution as being anything but secular. And the 42nd Amendment merely gave expression to those fundamental values which were always existing as part of our Constitution. But the Indian model of secularism is distinct from the US model, which advocates a bilateral exclusion of the state from religion and vice versa, as well as the French model, which advocates a one-way exclusion. Rather, it has been correctly asserted by a very distinguished contemporary scholar, Professor Rajiv Bhargav, that the Indian state exhibits a duality of both respect and disrespect for religion. Instead of disrespect, perhaps I would use the word indifference. Instead of a singular disinterest towards religion. Thus, the Indian state can and indeed does interfere with religion when undertaking a reformation of its negative aspects, which infringe upon the fundamental rights of our citizens. It has also been alleged that the makers of the Indian Constitution borrowed heavily from our colonial oppressors. It has been argued that many of the administrative provisions of the Indian Constitution find their roots in the colonial administrative structure which was created by the Government of India Act of 1935. However, before our Constitution succumbs to this allegation, we must first understand the unique context in which it was drafted. While our Constitution was similar to the likes of the American and the Australian constitutions, it was the result of a freedom struggle against our colonial oppressor and was influenced by the events of partition and the transgressions that took place during this period. A very distinguished contemporary political scientist, Sandeepto Dasgupta, has succinctly described the circumstances in which the Constituent Assembly found itself in the following words, which I quote. "The nature of the anti-colonial struggle that led to independence and the material conditions of Indian society at large meant that there was no existing consensus on the nature of a new political or social order. Therefore, the framers had to be attended simultaneously to both the creation of the Constitution and the conditions that make such a creation viable. Their task would hence be defined as crafting a constitution that brings about the conditions of its own possibility." Hence, the Constituent Assembly was essentially faced with a duality of its own role. And what was this duality of roles? It envisaged the drafting of the new constitution of the country and also of administering it in the interim in order to be able to foster a system where the new constitution could be effectively utilized. One must remember that our Constituent Assembly consisted of many leaders who had gained from their experiences and administrators under British rule. So it is unsurprising that they chose to continue with an administrative apparatus similar to the British in order to maintain administrative stability. However, it has been argued by Dasgupta that continuing with such an apparatus did not mean ignoring the most fundamental shift in the nature of the two regimes from an absolutist to a democratic one. So if you look at our constitution and the history of the freedom movement, there were two simultaneous movements which were taking place immediately before the birth of the constitution. At one level, the constitution intended to bring about a transfer of political power, a transfer of political power from a colonial regime to a democratic regime. But to look at the constitution merely as an instrument for the transfer of political power from a colonial to a homegrown, self-responsible regime would be really to miss the essence of the Constitution. Because simultaneously with the transfer of political power, there was another movement which was going on around the freedom struggle, and that was the movement for social reform. So the Constitution envisages itself in that sense to be a transformative document. A document which was intended to transform Indian society. And that is where you find the basis for provisions such as those which are dedicated to the upliftment of the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes. So this was never intended merely to be a political document witnessing a transfer of power. The essence of the Constitution was much broader. It was always intended to be a social transformative document which would envisage a transformation of Indian society from a caste-ridden feudal society to a society in which individual values would reign supreme, from a society which was deeply patriarchal. And those battles which the Constitution set down for itself are still continuing for us to face. This shift can be seen very clearly from a speech which Jawaharlal Nehru delivered to a new cadre of officers joining the Indian Police Service in 1952. Pandit Nehru insisted that since an enormous break had occurred from a non-democratic colonial regime to a democratic post-colonial one, it also necessitated a shift in the orientation of the executive. And he said, the police have not only to deal with crime and disorder in a general sort of way, but the real additional duty of the police, as of all of us, is that of dealing with human beings in the mass, not as something to be commanded or ordered about, but as something to be won over and persuaded and guided. Having now taken all of you through the history of some of our constitutional provisions, I hope I have been able to, if not discharge the myth that ours is a borrowed constitution, at least make us question its foundation. While undoubtedly our Constituent Assembly may have borrowed certain concepts from foreign constitutions, it firmly made them unique to India before incorporating them. But while we all know that the text of the Constitution often forms the clearest representation of its identity, the text is never coterminous with the soul of the Constitution. The identity of the Constitution has evolved. It has evolved through judicial interpretation. It has evolved through political conflict. And it has evolved through citizens' interfaces with the injustices which successive generations have faced and combated. This is most obviously seen from the line of cases that I referred to earlier, which ended up incorporating a due process clause in Article 21, similar to that of the US Constitution, even though the drafted text may have suggested otherwise. Similarly, the scope of Article 21 has been broadened to include multiple rights. One of the most recent cases is Puttaswamy, where our court read in the right to privacy in our Constitution. Cases such as this go on to reflect the role that our courts continue to play in developing the identity of our Constitution. But let's not be sanguine about the ability of the court to read life into the Constitution. The courts ultimately read a sense of vision, but that vision is necessarily limited by the ambit of the cases which come before the court. Far more significant to my mind to reading that vision into the Constitution is our daily interface as human beings, as citizens, with the Constitution. Our daily interface with our inability to combat the injustices of society, just as our daily interface with our ability to rise to the occasion. Indeed, Nani Palkhiwala had once said about our courts, and he said this, so long as the Constitution endures, these courts must exist. They decide the fierce controversies which in other countries are determined by the arbitrament of force. They maintain the most fundamental equilibriums of our society. They are the agency of a sovereign people to expound the Constitution and to ensure that its mandates are respected. A common factor which is noticeable in many cases, which have broadened the scope of rights available under Part 3, is their reliance on foreign jurisprudence in order to substantiate their reasoning. And this brings me to the second part of my lecture, which is about judicial borrowing from foreign courts. Before I begin to justify this form of judicial borrowing, it is imperative for me to state one commonly held view, that many of our core constitutional provisions, such as the one on fundamental rights or from interstate trade and commerce, are often drafted in abstract terms in order to facilitate their growth in the changes, with the changes of society around them. So we must always realize that the Constitution, though the Constitution has a soul, its words are couched in the abstract. And the real craftsmanship of a judge lies in infusing those words with the soul which we wish the Constitution to perceive and possess. Therefore, I believe that when judges engage in constitutional interpretation of these rather abstract principles, it is quite useful to look at how other judges in other jurisdictions have similarly considered the problems which confront them. Gary Jurgensen, Gary Jacobson, a very eminent scholar, argues that borrowing of foreign constitutional material is useful in closing the gap which arises between the aspirations of a society and the actual constitutional rules which are in place. His thesis is one which arises from a contextualist approach to judicial borrowing, which tries to place the foreign legal norms within the context of a country's unique situation before using them. On the other hand, you have scholars such as Sujit Chaudhary who recommend a dialogical model of borrowing, where comparative constitutional materials are interpretative tools or tools for constitutional self-reflection. They help in identifying exactly what is special or distinctive about our constitutional order, since its uniqueness arises only in comparison to others. Hence, when we engage with material arising from constitutions other than our own, we learn from their experiences in having dealt with situations similar to ours. Through their experiences, we question the assumptions they have made, which in turn serve as stimuli for us to question our own assumptions about our constitutional order. Therefore, such an engagement, according to distinguished scholars, is not really a borrowing, but is using the foreign material to critically reassess our own constitutional ideas. Now, if we were to start considering the objections to the use of foreign legal material or constitutional thoughts drawn from a variety of international sources, Justice Scalia of the United States Supreme Court often held the strongest opposition. Justice Scalia argued that since such materials were not binding on the judges, they should not be used at all. He believed that there was no reason why the United States, given its unique constitution and constitutional history, should even try to conform with the traditions of the rest of the world. I believe that what this approach ignores is the unified bond of humanity that links us across jurisdictions, cultures, and ideas. Even in our own court, a similar objection to the use of foreign legal material was noted in the judgment in Suresh Kumar Kaushal. By overturning the judgment of the Delhi High Court in Nas Foundation, there was a refusal to engage with foreign jurisprudence cited by the Delhi High Court in order to understand the violation of the rights of the members of the LGBTQ community under Articles 14, 15 and 21. It was argued that a decision of a foreign court passed in a foreign context could not be made applicable to ourselves. However, our court, while overturning the decision of Suresh Kumar in Navtej Johar, relied upon a substantial amount of comparative material from other jurisdictions while coming to its own conclusion. I believe that this form of judicial borrowing is similar to the borrowing done by our Constituent Assembly, because in engaging with such foreign legal material, we have not considered ourselves bound blindly by that reasoning. To the contrary, they have been used to broaden our own understanding of the rights individuals possess under our constitutional framework. And above all, let us not ever forget that India has been enriched by its contact with cultures, with religions, drawn from the East and the West. Let us never forget that the strength of our society lies in its plurality, in its ability to assimilate change, even if that change appears to question some of our most fundamental assumptions. Justice Albie Sachs of the South African Constitutional Court has said, "When I draw on statements by certain US Supreme Court justices, I do so not because I treat their decisions as precedents to be applied in our courts, but because their dicta articulate in an elegant and helpful manner problems which face any modern court. Thus, though drawn from another legal culture, they express values and dilemmas in a way which I found most helpful in elucidating the meaning of our own constitutional text." In fact, if one were to look at the history of our Supreme Court, one would find that the use of foreign legal material has always been prevalent. The only opposition to it has been when they have been accepted uncritically and without thought to our own constitutional provisions. It would also do us well to not forget that the origin of the basic structure doctrine evolved in the Keshwan and the Bharati case was also from an article written by the German scholar Dietrich Conrad. Therefore, I find no hesitation in stating that judges can and rather should engage with materials from foreign jurisdictions while interpreting our own constitution. Doing so will not take away from the Indianness of the constitution's unique identity, because the migration of ideas only contributes in its evolution without transplanting its soul. Above all, let us not forget that the constitution is intended to evolve with the changes in our times. Our dialogue with the constitution as citizens cannot be stultified. Our dialogue with our own constitution cannot be frozen. And that is how you see that a constitution which had been intended to be a constitution with a strong center over the years, particularly in the decades of the 80s, the 90s, and then post 2000, has now become an increasingly federalist model, a constitution which acknowledges differences and acknowledges the strength of the polity as it lies in the states where real power resides today. Our constitution has been shaped, for instance, in the context of interstate trade and commerce, by recognizing that the fundamental precepts which guided us in laying down the principles in the 1950s and 1970s, including cases like Atiyabari, automobile transport, had to undergo a change to acknowledge that the states must now have a larger role to play in the shaping of the destinies of the nation. It is important for us to remember that ultimately, the idea of any constitution finds its deepest meaning in the role of people and their actions. The constitution expects its citizens to fully realize its transformative potential. Why is the transformative potential so important after all? It's important because our framers, while adopting the constitution, were also aware of the immense social challenges lying ahead of their times. They knew that the real duty of transforming society would ultimately depend on citizens. History would not judge our constitution by the uniqueness it exhibited. Instead, it would judge them by the transformation that it entailed. While the three wings of the government are tasked with their own constitutional mandates, the mantle of achieving the transformative ideals of our constitution lies equally with citizens. In that context, Hannah Pitkin, a leading scholar in political science, puts it beautifully in these words, and she says, "Constitutions are made, not found. They do not fall miraculously from the sky or grow naturally on the vine. They are human creations, products of convention, choice, the specific history of a particular people, and almost always a political struggle in which some win and others lose. Indeed, in this vein, one might even want to argue that our constitution is more something we do than something we make. We reshape it all the time through our collective activity. The task of realizing the vision of the Indian constitution falls upon every single citizen every day and in everything that we do." In that context, as I conclude, I'm reminded of the prescient words of the great Nani Palkhiwala himself when he said, "We the people of India adopted, enacted and gave to ourselves the constitution. We the people are also its only keepers. There is need in our time and land to remind ourselves that the constitution is intended not merely to provide for the exigencies of the moment, but to endure through a long lapse of years. The constitution was meant to impart such a momentum to the living spirit of the rule of law that democracy and civil liberty may survive in India beyond our times and in the days when our place will know us no more. Freedom cannot be inherited in the bloodstream. Each generation will have to defend it and fight for it. Then alone will it survive to be passed on to the next." Among the books, Nani had written two books titled We the People and We the Nation. When Nani passed away, a poster regarding his death described the loss most succinctly by saying, "We the nation, we the people have lost a legend." I would like to take the liberty to change that slightly to describe how I truly feel. We the nation, we the people were fortunate to have had such a legend amongst us. Thank you very much.